Good evening. On what I, after what I know has been a long day for you. On behalf of the faculty and staff, I'm Melinda Tevenhoff. I'm the Associate Dean for the Undergraduate Program here at GW. And I want to welcome you and congratulate you on behalf of all the faculty and staff for our inaugural white coat ceremony. This is really exciting. It comes from support from the Arnold Gold Foundation, and we are just delighted to be a part of it to signal this transition for you into professional nursing. Tonight, we'll hear some reflections of some leaders in nursing who also happen to be at our school. You'll receive your coats from the various program directors, and then we'll have an opportunity for refreshments. Hopefully out on the terrace upstairs, but based on the clouds coming in from the west, we might have to be flexible on that, which is what nurses are, right? Always flexible. Well, our first speaker this evening to offer us some reflections on this event is Dean Johnson. And as far as leaders within GW and leaders within nursing as a whole, we are doubly fortunate because not only is she our dean, but has years of experience. And as you do your lit searches, I actually had this experience just a couple of days ago where I was looking up something or preparing for a committee. Oh, Jean Johnson. Oh, Jean Johnson. Oh, there's only one. And it is her preparing for a committee. Oh, well, I know who I could ask about that committee. I am always humbled and honored to be able to work with you and to introduce you this evening to offer some remarks.
It's always interesting. When I was younger, I don't know that I put much value on tradition and symbolism. Now that I've become older and wiser, I think, I recognize how important tradition and symbolism is, and the white coat that you're going to be putting on today is very symbolic. And as Dr. Tevenhoff had said, this is actually our first white coat ceremony, you know, as a school of nursing. And, you know, certainly made possible by the Arnold Gold Foundation, but this is something that we're going to continue because, you know, the tradition of moving into a clinical experience is really important. In fact, I was sort of reflecting with a couple of my colleagues because I was trying to remember, you know, exactly, you know, what the tradition was when I went through school, you know, and when some of the others of us had. And before going into a clinical site, we got our caps. You know, the tradition was the capping ceremony. Well, the good news is that nurses don't wear caps anymore. We do wear white coats, but I think that the symbolism of the clinical service is just really important. You know, I'm not sure what you all are really thinking this evening, but given that you had your first exam, you know, what, at 8 a.m. this morning? and I, not to mention any faculty names, but, you know. but hopefully you're not at the point of thinking, why am I here? You know, what was I thinking, you know, when I applied and decided to become a nurse? You know, because that exam is only the beginning, and you all will be doing really well. I would guess, though, that you might be a little nervous thinking about going into a clinical site and actually being responsible for people and people's well-being. You might be anxious about what the white coat means and the responsibilities that it carries. But my guess is that you also will feel proud about wearing a white coat, you know, and being recognized as a health professional. And I think that that's really important. And my guess is that you may also feel excited about really beginning the heart and soul of nursing, which is clinical practice. You know, you've got to have the knowledge background. You've got to do your, experiences in the simulation lab and whatnot. But it's really the clinical sites that are the heart and soul of nursing. So, you know, you'll begin to understand what nursing is about probably from day one in your clinical side. And when I was thinking about, so what did I want to say to you tonight? You know, I started thinking back on my very first patient that I was assigned to, and I can tell you, I remember everything about this very first patient. And he was a young man, he was a senior, ending his senior year in high school, had been at a party, everybody was drinking, and it was a pool party, and he dove into the shallow end of the pool. And he not only dove into a shallow end of the pool, but he actually swam to the far side of the pool, got out, shook his head, and severed his spine at the C5 level. Now, my instructor in med surg assigned me to this young man. And I was an older student, you know, in the class because I was actually a second degree student. And I thought, okay, maybe by sheer force of my will, I can be helpful to this young man. What I didn't know immediately was that the nursing staff had actually asked my instructor to assign a student, that they thought that maybe a student could be helpful to this young man who had become very angry, very depressed, and clearly, you know, didn't see a future, you know, in front of him. And so, you know, here I am, Nurse Jean, you know, going into the room for the first time, and this young man cursed at me, you know, probably, you know, said everything that could make you really feel like that, you know, as a new student nurse or even as an experienced nurse. You know, so I had several times of thinking, I can't do this. And in fact, I went to my clinical instructor. And I asked my clinical instructor to reassign me. I said, I can't do this. I can't help this young man. And she would not reassign me. And I thought at the time that my instructor just didn't get it, you know, didn't get how seriously, you know, a situation, how serious the situation was. And I had thought at the time, you know, that not only could I not deal with this patient, but maybe I shouldn't be a nurse. What really turned things around was my instructor, you know, who kept tabs on me very closely, and I reached out to her many times, you know, kind of asking for advice and, you know, what kinds of things could I do, you know, that kind of thing. And the other resource, you know, were my fellow students. And you all will be each other's resource, you know, in these clinical situations. Now, as it turned out, you know, I worked with this young man for an entire semester, you know, 2, sometimes 3 days a week. And we actually made some progress. And by the time I had left, you know, he was engaging in the rehabilitation, you know, sorts of activities that he could. And we stayed in touch for a couple of years, and then I lost touch with him. But, you know, it was such a memorable experience that, you know, and such an overwhelming experience. Don't be surprised, you know, if you encounter, you know, sort of some similar situations, because the world of nursing is full of similar situations. You know, there's another side of nursing, you know, because that's kind of the inside side of nursing in terms of all of the doubts and the fears and the, you know, thinking, oh, I can't do this. But the other side is the rewards. And the rewards in nursing and in clinical practice are absolutely huge. When you can go home at the end of the day and say, wow, you know, I really was able to make a difference for Mr. Smith, Mrs. Jones, whomever it is, you know, whether it be a child, a new mother, you know, an elderly person with a hip fracture, whatever the situation is, and you can go home and say, I actually made a difference in somebody's life today. There's nothing better than that. There is really professionally nothing better than that. And that's the reward of nursing. That's what keeps us in nursing. That's what drew us to nursing in the first place, thinking that we could make a difference. And you can. You can make a huge difference. The being a nurse, you know, you will get everybody's opinions about nursing. Just by being in school, you would be surprised, strangers on the street, if they find out that you're a nurse or in a nursing school, will have something to say to you about nursing. And, you know, I've sort of categorized these stories over the years because almost a day doesn't go by, you know, when somebody doesn't want to offer some view of nursing to me. And people's views, you know, they have been either they've had not such a great experience with nursing care, you know, that they didn't feel like nurses listened to them, they didn't feel like, you know, they got the attention in the time that they needed it, or that they got the right attention. And then there are those people who have, who go, oh, the nurses were terrific. They made the difference in my life. You know, they are the ones that, you know, really knew what was going on. They listened to us. They gave us the right information, you know, and we needed it. And I don't know how I would have gotten through whatever the situation was without the nurses. You know, and that's what we all want to hear. You know, we want a world of the best nurses. And that's what you all are going to be. Because you're not going to leave this program and be a nurse that might compromise patient care, that might not be providing the best and the latest care. You're going to be the ones that people on the street will come up to you and go, God, I love nursing. You know, they are the best. They know what's going on. Because that's what really good nurses do. Good nurses, as I said, make a difference in people's lives and what they can do. In fact, the truth is that you won't know the impact that you really have on people's lives fully. You never will. You know, because people will come and go and you'll have, you know, contact with them in some way, either in the hospital, in a clinic, in home care, in end-of-life care, you know, in some situation. And, you know, you may know the immediacy of what your care has done, but you won't know the long-term lasting impact. And you might be one of those people in people's lives that they remember forever, forever, in terms of what you were able to help them with. So, as you're moving into the clinical, you know, I think that knowing that there are immense rewards, you know, I think that putting on your light, your white coat, you know, means that you're ready to commit yourself. And you're committing yourself to a really incredible profession. So now I am very pleased to introduce, you know, Dr. Mary Jean Schumann, the Senior Associate Dean for Academic Affairs. Thank you.
Can you all hear me?
Okay.
Okay. So good evening. I want to add my welcome to that of Dr. Johnson's as each of you join as blooming nurses as part of the profession. You are joining over 300 million or 3 million other nurses. That is one for every 100 individuals in this country. So think about it. You have the opportunity to make a personal change in over 100 people's lives just by being in the community as a nurse. This is a very powerful and exemplary profession by other standards as well as our own. Nursing has had a long and rich history as a profession. It first began to organize to manage itself for the good of patients as far back as 1897, so about 120 years ago. At least two branches of the military are formally recognized nursing back then, The Army Nurse Corps was established in 1901 and the Navy Nurse Corps in 1908. And did you know that the first BSN program in nursing was established in 1909? So we have a very rich and long history. For all but one of the last 15 years, 2001, nursing has ranked as the most trusted profession by the American public. As part of its long and trustworthy history, nursing has developed numerous traditions, and one in which you will experience upon your graduation in just 15 short months is the lighting of the lamp in recognition of Florence Nightingale, one of our foremost early leaders in nursing. Another ceremony is the pinning ceremony, where you will receive the School of Nursing pin at graduation with the expectation that you will represent this School of Nursing with integrity, with dedication, and with passion. So today, as Jean has said, you are contributing to the establishment of another tradition for the school. And while students in medicine have typically received their white coats as a symbol of their achievement of an early milestone in their preparation as physicians, this is a tradition new to nursing and replacing that of the cap, which Dr. Johnson talked about. This is the first white coat ceremony ever for our School of Nursing. And thanks to the grant and in conjunction with the American Association of Colleges of Nursing, 100 nursing schools across the country, including ours, will be providing similar ceremonies this fall. So think about you being one of 100 schools doing this. The white coat and the ceremony mark the initiation of your journey into the profession. You have been in the simulation laboratory, right? You have been in classes to learn how to conduct yourself with individuals for whom you will be learning to provide nursing care. Over the next week, each of you will embark upon a journey into a real patient's room, whether it be in a hospital or a nursing home, and you will be accorded the special privilege of assisting that individual on their own journey, either into improved health or into the maintenance of functional wellness, or into a more respectful and comfortable decline in function. This white coat symbolizes that each of you are committing that you are personally ready to step into that most serious relationship, a nurse-patient relationship. And your commitment requires that you, regardless of the individual and their circumstances, accord each individual in your care the respect for their own values, their own beliefs, and their own shared preferences. It requires that you convey accurate and timely information about all options for their care, even if those include options that you personally would not choose. And that you do so in a way that meets your patient's abilities to process and use that information. So if their educational level is not equivalent to yours, you need to figure out how to provide that information in a way that meets their need. It requires that you enter into the dialogue with that individual and his or her family with a goal that they are the key decision maker about their own health and their health care. It requires also that you advocate on behalf of each individual in your care, that you align yourself with your patient's own efforts to advocate on their own behalf, and that you advocate for them when they themselves cannot, even when it is difficult or inconvenient to do so. And it requires that you maintain confidentiality of that individual's information and circumstances, regardless of who it is or where it is. So Dr. Johnson has shared with you those personal experiences of being a student nurse, of what it is like to have your first patient, or to give your first injection, or to be confronted with someone close to your own ages who is dreadfully or maybe even terminally ill. You may find yourself thrust into awkward circumstances such as providing care or participating in conversations of an intimate nature that you would have never expected you would have to join into. You may question whether or not you will ever do these things competently. Yes, one day you will. You may be afraid to respond to the patient for fear you will say something that will make them feel worse. You may see affected body parts and wonder how you will ever avoid showing your own feelings. I suspect that all of the faculty are here who can relate to these in their own experiences. So this is why each of the faculty here are your best resource. We have all been in your place. We remember what it was like. We have seen and supported other students like this or with these soul-searching issues. We are not only ready but eager to support nurses and students to become the nurse who can reach inside and give a little more than you thought you even possessed. To be calm, to be non-judgmental, and at the same time, to be genuine in your emotions with the patient and with the family. So never lose sight of the privilege you are now being given to be privy to someone else's pain, to be able to intervene or to advocate for their reduction in pain, their indecisions, and their choices about care. You are a guest in their lives. They are placing their trust and often their lives in your hands, and they, as patients, realize what you may yet not know, that you will be the safety net when all else fails in the healthcare system. Your competence will be what stands between them and a medication error, a disastrous fall, or another negative outcome. So there's a framed saying that one of my daughters gave to me nearly 20 years ago, which still hangs in my living room. It says, as parents, we give our children two things. One is roots and the other is wings. And as nursing faculty, we give you, our students, two things. One is the roots of a profession and a knowledge base that is higher in integrity and trustworthiness than any other. The other is wings to fly successfully, committed and competent upon graduation. Those roots will be with you forever if you commit to them now. Remember, once a nurse, always a nurse. No matter what else you do in your lives, that nursing route will be part of your makeup. Whatever you do, remember those roots. They are strong, they are sturdy, they are founded in knowledge and evidence, yet they will lift your wings that allow you to fly. So over time, you will find yourself putting on your white coat automatically, or on the run, or draping it over your car seat after a clinical day. So please stop when you do that, even just for a few seconds, each day when you take it on or off, and think about what it symbolizes. Did you remember your roots? Did you or will you do it justice today? Did you meet the commitment that you made today, September 4th, 2014?
Dr. Zonis and Dr. Schumann, thank you so much for those reflections. And we're now going to go into the actual coding ceremony. And I think you'll be directed, I'm going to invite the directors up in just a second to coat you and shake your hands as you walk across. You'll hand your card with your name on it to me. Thank you if you put ways to pronounce it best. And if not, I owe you candy, which you can collect at Ms. Mance's office. So at this time, I'd like to invite our program directors up, Dr. Reisenberg, Dr. Whitlow, and Dr. Albana, and Dean Johnson, and Dr. Schumann, if you'd like to join us as well. Christy Haynes. Jack Hooper. Kellen Marion. Andrew Pierce. Ashley Schrader. Deirdre Tiffany. Paulina Lerman. Mickey Parsley. Rhonda Patterson. Lenita Williams. Helen Sun. Jillian Brown. Virginia Wu. Ashley Weston. Shakira Mosby. Brittany Philibin. Kristen Wolf. Kareen Douglas. Abby Schreider. Kathy Carr. Raven Morton. Jana Caldwell. Rachel Thornton. Frances Junker. Dana Leese. Deborah Yuen. Devin McEwen. Kira McQuiston. Amanda Ward. Jessica Green. Debbie Awad. Kristen Regini. Tiffany Houston. Fernanda Roca. Jihoon Du. Nubia Sanchez. Melissa Gihiloff. Kiera Dykes. Kevin Edwards. Christy Massey. DiSarcho. I think that was DiSarcho. I owe you candy. Drew Loon. Andrea Yuseem. Maddie Crowell. Lauren Beeler. Lindsay Noller. Carla Sandler. Grace Yoon. Tatiana Polino. Charity James. Michelle Maddox. Sarah Liu. Stacia Moreno. Greta Carlholm. Leah Fricke. Jessica Candelaria. Rachel Lee. Aviana Everett. Molly Caton. Kathy Umnatbaum. Congratulations. I wish you could see what we see from the front. So impressive, so professional, ready to go. We will now recite the pledge that you should have in front of you. And faculty, if you want to go back to your, yeah. And we can sit down here and read too.
Oh, good, look, it's there.
And it's right here, even better. So let's all please stand to recite the oath. And recite with me, please. As a nurse dedicated to providing the highest quality care and services, I solemnly pledge that I will consider the welfare of humanity and relief of suffering my primary concerns, act in a compassionate and trustworthy manner in all aspects of my care, apply my knowledge, experience, and skills to the best of my ability to assure optimal outcomes for my patients, exercise sound professional judgment while abiding by legal and ethical requirements, accept the lifelong obligation to improve my professional knowledge and competence, promote, advocate for, and strive to protect the health, safety, and rights of the patient. With this pledge, I accept the duties and responsibilities that embody the nursing profession. I take this oath voluntarily with the full realization of the responsibility with which I am entrusted by the public. Congratulations. Please join us for refreshments that are out on the terrace. Excellent. On the third floor. And celebrate.